Okay, everybody. Hopefully that's everybody. It's great to see so many faces. So what we're going to do today is a mixture of things. We're actually thinking that the most useful thing for you guys will to actually be to spend most of the time actually playing with LandLab yourselves. And to that end, we've got a few tutorials that you can get at on the web that we would recommend that you work through. But before we get there, the first thing we want to do is actually just give you a brief, like 10, 15 minute chat through what LandLab is, roughly how it works, how it's structured, sort of a general overview, but just a short one. But before I kick off, I want to try and bring up the LandLab development team. So please come up, LandLab development team, and let everyone see your beautiful faces. And missing from this group is Erkan Istanbulgu. Is that the correct pronunciation of Erkan's surname? Say it louder. There you go. Erkan. And Eric Hutton, who is one of the CSDMS guys, and he is presently next door in the Dakota session. He sends his apologies. If any of you have any super technical questions, he's probably your man to go to, because he is our resident, I know how computers work guy. Okay, so, but we'll, like, grab any of us at any time, and we will bend your ear about LandLab at any moment. Yes, oh yeah, sorry, I should have introduced you guys. We have Sai. We have, what? Oh, what? Yes, all the whole room? Okay, let's do it. Go.
I'm Jordan,
We want a sense of your, we want to know who our community is, essentially, because we quite like some feedback from you so we can make things more awesome. So,
thank you.
Thank you, guys. So, also, just bookkeeping before we start, how many of you, in an honest, no-shaming environment, have actually not installed LandLab yet on your computers? Okay, that's good. No, that's manageable. In that case, I won't spend any time now telling you that. We'll come and find you guys and deal with that problem on the fly. Secondly, how many of you are, let's say, familiar with Python? Okay, how many are unfamiliar with Python? Okay, that is good to know. So, importantly, Python, LandLab is coded in Python, and we will come on to exactly why shortly. However, anyone who's got any passing familiarity with MATLAB and scripting in MATLAB is probably not going to take very long to pick up Python, but we will spend some time talking about that just at the end of this talk, so those of you who do know Python already aren't going to be hanging around waiting for us. Okay, so LandLab, finally. Let's give you some motivation before we actually get stuck in. So, if you type a landscape evolution model into Google, in fact, a couple of months ago now, this is the first, how many is this? 10 images you see? And hopefully most of you can see some of your old friends if you spent any time doing landscape evolution in here. Here are the various authors that correspond to this. But what I want you to take away from this slide is not only landscape evolution models, there are a lot of them out there, but even more generally, if you want to talk about surface process models in the even more broad sense, so now I'm talking about things like surface hydrology, eco-hydrology, land use dynamics. There are loads and loads and loads of these things out there. And if you think about the amount of cumulative man hours involved in building all of those things from the ground up, it's kind of horrifying. So the original motivation for developing LandLab was that we wanted to provide the community with a tool that allows you to get from the point of I have nothing to I have a working model of whatever it was I cared about faster. And something else that's really worth emphasizing at this point is a number of you are probably familiar with Child, which is Greg, one of Greg's older and extremely popular community landscape evolution model. I want to emphasize LandLab is not Child. They are different things. In no way are we superseding Child here. It's a complementary, different approach, where the approach is we give to you a set of tools. So LandLab is a framework, it's a modeling framework. So we give you tools, we give you a model grid, we give you a way of interacting with the model that is very standardized and therefore very fast to code in, and that you can then either use the various process components that we provide with LandLab that describe things that the people who coded LandLab originally were interested in, so fluvial incision processes, hill slope diffusion, rainfall drivers, wildfire drivers, ecohydrology, various little actual components that do things we were interested in. But the intent is that you can either take those and play with them as is, or we would encourage you to go away and build your own modules that describe things that you're interested in, and then you can just plug your little module into LandLab, and you're there. You don't have to redesign a grid. You don't have to code everything else that isn't actually what you're interested in. Say you want to do a fire model. You can just code the bit of LandLab that describes the fire and then just place it on top of our existing fluvial hill slope components. That's the vision. We're getting there now. So beyond that, our mission statement here is that we want to be open access. We want to be a community thing, quite consciously. We want to not rely on anyone else, but with that in mind, we don't want to have to make any of you buy anything. So all of LandLab is, we make extensive use of other open source software in the building, but none of you will ever have to buy MATLAB or buy Arc to use LandLab. Very importantly, we are deliberately, and when we started building LandLab, we consciously want to be 100% compatible with the CSDMS interfaces. What that means from your perspective is if you're building on LandLab, you don't have to worry about designing your CMT interface. Because you're building onto LandLab, we give that to you. So that's another advantage from your perspective as another labor-saving device. We want to be quick to learn, we want to be quick to code. We want you to be able to develop quickly. And that is the main motivation for why we've chosen Python So Python is, for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, is a relatively new high-level programming language, in that it isn't like C, where you have to sit down, you have to define everything, and you have to allocate memory. It does all of the boring and unpleasant bits of coding for you. So it handles like MATLAB. It feels like you just make a variable, and the machine, and that Python goes off and does it for you. You don't have to worry about all of that sort of bookkeeping. And again, as I emphasized, we want to be modular, so you can, things are plug and play. You take processes and you plug them together and they just play with each other. And there's no real unpleasant weaving required to really make those things work together. And we want to be flexible. I hope that made sense to everyone. What's actually going on in terms of, I alluded to this earlier, what's actually inside LandLab then as a package? It's basically three things. There's a grid, and if you look in the file structure, you'll see this very clearly. There's a grid which describes the geometry of the surface over which you're doing your process modeling. So it's, but in we'll see that in a moment. There is data on that grid, and there are functions that then let you query things about the grid. So you say, oh, I want to know all of the nodes that are next to other nodes, and that we provide you with all these functions in LandLab. So you can produce, say, a diffusion model, and you'll see that in the tutorials very quickly, because we give you all of the things, the major components that you would need to build that. There are then process components, and this is really the science of LandLab. This is where we have fluvial processes, hillslope processes, your favorite processes, all bundled up. We ship a library of these with LandLab, and that will constantly be expanding, but we advocate that the community adds to these, and the more and more and more we get, the better and better and better LandLab gets, right? Because it just snowballs. And we also provide you with a set of utilities, and by utilities, I'm talking about essentially input-output functions, interface functions, CMT functions, all the things that are just the things you have to have in order to code, but you don't really want to be worrying about them. So we're letting you interact with DEMs, we're letting you output data, all of those utilities. You can just call them as one-liners from LandLab. So any of you who've ever used Child, and indeed any landscape model in general, will probably be familiar with the kind of concept of our grid. If you've used Child, the way it works will feel very childlike to you, in that it's built essentially of nodes which are joined together by links, and that all of the processes, most of the values, and that you store the values of whatever it is you're talking about, elevation, fluxes, on those nodes and links. We give you explicit control of cell status, so you can handle the boundary conditions very easily. And we provide you with a set of functions that let you interrogate that grid. Give me a list of all the links. Give me a list of all the nodes. Give me a list of all the core nodes that are inside the grid and not on the edge. Those kind of functions. Importantly, we're not limited to raster. I'm showing you a raster here, but we are implementing raster functions, a raster grid, Voronoi grid, so an unstructured grid, and subsets of Voronoi. We make it very easy for you to set up hexagonal grids, radial grids. I'm missing one. It's gone from my mind right now. But if you want a standard grid type, we're hoping that we can just provide you with that. We don't yet have quad trees, but we are very aware that we want them, and this will be coming soon. And so, essentially, you have your grid, you have your data. The data lives on the nodes and links, and the power of the methods we give you, essentially, is so that you can do things like, hey, LandLab, tell me what the core nodes in my grid are. And it says, well, there's your core nodes. And then you say, LandLab, tell me what the elevations are at the core nodes. And it goes, there you go. So that is very much the way that LandLab interface works. It holds lists of all of the properties and the data on those properties, and then you can interrogate them very easily with that interface. And you'll see this in the tutorials very clearly. But what many of you are probably interested in is this. So, as I said, we provide you with a library of components. Here's a brief whistle-stop tour through the components we already have in largely working order. I apologize if any of you go to draw one of these out of the current version of LandLab and find it doesn't work, but hopefully all of these are essentially functional. You get bonus points if you can guess the esoteric illustrations and what they actually correspond to. We have rainfall driver. We have hill slope properties. We have flow routing and channel erosion. We have soil moisture. We have various eco-hydrology modules. We have, not yet, but imminently, some shallow ice flow tools. We have an impact cratering module. We have a shear stress module that lets you calculate shear stresses across the landscape. We have a fire module. We have a shallow flow module. We have flexure. And we also have, this is bonus points for this one, we have implementation for simple cellular methods in LandLab. So one of the things we're hopeful that will be useful to the community is you can run conventional, essentially continuum models of, say, hill slope processes. But on top of that, you can be running like a cellular automata vegetation model. And the LandLab's interface will let you do that. And you can just have the two layers going at the same time and talking to each other with the minimum of fuss. As I said, we give you utilities. And by utilities, we mean all of the stuff that you need to do but probably isn't super exciting science to you. We give you tools to read DEMs so you can output from ARC and input into LandLab and run on a DEM. We can read text files. And in fact, LandLab has a reasonably well-developed input interface for, so you can just have essentially lists of the various parameters you need to run your model in a text file, and we give you all the tools you need to strip that out of the text file and bring it into LandLab. We have output routines that will spit out things like NetCDF, VTK, and we give you a bunch of visualization tools that will let you plot, and various other things that you don't want to be worried with as coders, you just want them to happen. We try and provide you with as many of those as we can think of. Now, just to finish off, I want to give you a very quick visualization of some of those components we already have that you can dig around in and find. First one, we have shallow flow modules. And with that, you can do things like simulating flood wave propagation. So what you can see here is a simulated channel which had a dam at this end, which was removed at time zero. And this is the elevation of a flood wave propagating along. This is a very simple implementation of this based on the Bates et al. Algorithm that some of you might be familiar with from 2010. This is very simple, but there is absolutely no reason why further down the line we can't replace this with much more sophisticated underlying shallow flow modules. But we give you something to get going with. We can simulate overland flow, we can route flow, and we can direct it, and we allow various different methods of routing flow. You can choose them. Do I want D4? Do I want D8? Do I want D-infinity? Those are there for you. So there's an illustration of taking a DEM which has been ingested into LandLab and routing flow and just working out what the water depths would be at steady state. And again, you can then get time series just by picking a pixel and saying, tell me what the time series was at this pixel, and off it goes. Similarly, once you have that, it's very simple to go into shear stress world. LandLab has shear stress functions, and again, you can see at three different pixels in this catchment, you can pull out time series very simply of whatever it is you're interested in. We have diffusion modules in place, and so what we have here is a simple block uplift with two open boundaries and two closed boundaries, and I think this is an implementation, correct me if I'm wrong, Greg, of a linear diffusion. And this is actually correct. If you compare this to the analytical solution, we're good. So we provide you with linear diffusion module. We provide you with nonlinear diffusion module. And so this is a case with four open boundaries being uplifted nonlinearly. And you can see the expected linear hill, straight critical hill slopes that arise if you have that model. We give you that too. We have stream power modules in place. So you can model simple drainage networks and how they incise into an uplifting block on a long time scale. And of course, with those two things in mind, any of you who are landscape people might immediately think, can you couple those together? The answer is yes. So LandLab lets you, here's an illustration of that. Here's a simple block, let me get my mind straight. Here is a simple just stream power equilibrium solution using LandLab. And in this case, it's the same equilibrium stream power solution, but it's also coupled to linear diffusion. So we can do this now. There are some idiosyncrasies about the way the model, the coupling works still, but those will be ironed out in a few weeks. We're cautiously optimistic. I know we'll skip over that. We have an impact cratering module. That's probably not of particular interest to that many of you, but I'm quite excited that this exists. I'm trying to spin up some of this at the moment. We have flexure tools, so you can simulate isostatic compensation for your structure. And what this is showing you is 10, I think it's 10, randomly placed onto the grid, randomly allocated weights, and that this is the deflection field that would result from that. And again, obviously, this is something that you want to couple with other processes. Here's an illustration of coupling a surface that's been created with that flexure. So you can just run these two things together. You can say, run the craters, run the flexure, and everything just works. And again, as I alluded to earlier, that we have cellular automata methods. Greg is the man to talk to about this. These are still somewhat experimental, but we're hoping that this is something that we can really press on with. And what you can see here is a very much non-landscape evolution use of LandLab, and that's something we should emphasize. This is not just a landscape evolution model. It's a process modeling environment. We are not constrained just pretending that LandLab is modeling a surface. So what we're modeling here is a 2D slice through essentially a rock with fractures in it, and this is a simple cellular automata method of weathering away from those fractures. Okay, so Python is, LandLab is a Python-based, flexible, quick-to-learn, open-source surface process model. We give you a selection of modules, but we encourage you to get involved and essentially tell us what you want from LandLab, and we will make it happen. And with that in mind, I think it's probably time for you guys to get going. So, if you, all of you who actually already have LandLab, this is good. But what we would recommend you do is you go to landlab.readthedocs.org. Hopefully this site is familiar to most of you because you probably went through this to do your download. And what we would recommend you start by doing is this tutorial to LandLab right here. And that should get you all started and introduce you to the basic ways that LandLab works. Our intent is just to circulate around the room and talk to you guys and watch what you're doing. If you have questions, just stick your hands up and ask us those questions. We think that's probably the most effective way of this working. Those of you who are quick will probably get through that in not too long. We would then recommend you come down here and start working on these other slightly more expanded tutorials. We're recommending you do, there are three of these available. The first one talks a bit more in detail about the basic functionality of LandLab and will get you good at seeing what's there, how it works, how the grid works, how to build with LandLab. The second one is a bit more abstracted. It's talking about how you can, a recommended way that you can use the components we provide you with. Something else we should emphasize is although we have a recommended way that you can use LandLab, we're coding to a design with the assumption that you'll do LandLab this way. We're also very aware that you will want to use it in your own way, and we're trying to keep everything as flexible as possible. So even though we have what, so those of you who are coding, LandLab is very object orientated. There is quite a lot of automation going on behind the scenes, but if you want to use it essentially as a scripting language, where you're not running very heavily sort of developed code, you just want to script things and get answers, LandLab will work in that mode as well. It's just that we recommend you have there's a standard way of using it, but we're very conscious that you'll want to play with it and break it and do what you want, essentially. And so the second component here is the recommended and our current thinking on the best way to couple those components that we give you together and how they look, how they work. And the third thing here is from Cy, and it's a bit more about how one of our components in particular works, and that is much more eco-hydrology orientated. And so he's your man if you fancy going that way. So essentially, begin. So those of you who are not happy with Python, maybe if some of you can, those of you can come more to the front and we can have a bit of a chat about some of the things you probably need to know about Python before diving in. But those of you who have used Python before, we're cautiously optimistic that you can essentially just go for it now and everything will work. So please self-organize at this point. Oh, and those of you who don't have LandLab installed, stick your hands up and wave frantically at someone, and someone will come and help you. Was that relatively
good? No, that was great, but I just realized... Okay.
One second, I'll be right over, okay?
I
Yeah, mine probably just like, oh, I know what she's talking about. I'll just do that. So.
Yeah.
Hey guys, we're coming towards the end of the session. Something I would like to share with you before we get there, though. You've all just, or most of you, I hope, have made forks of the GitHub LandLab repository. What you'll find is that means from the point you make the fork, you can't automatically see our changes. I'm going to email all of you with how you get around that problem so that you can keep your little fork up to date with the changes that we make. I've just figured that out and I didn't know it before. So I will email the group and share that knowledge with you, because otherwise you'll just end up with like a fossilized, out of date version of LandLab. And it's easy to do, but you just need to know where to click on the website to make it happen. So expect that to appear in your inboxes. And thank you all for coming.